So that you are going to see that metastatic brain tumors, not the primary brain tumors, are the most common. Metastatic brain tumors is the most common, comprising about 15 to 20% of all brain tumors. Among the primary, the most frequent are gliomas, followed by meningiomas. Gliomas, in fact, they are tumors of the connective tissue of the brain, and meningiomas are tumors of the meninges. Glioma more frequent in males, and meningiomas are more frequent in females. In children, brain tumors are the second most common after leukemia. 70% are leukemia, and the most frequent are cerebral astrocytoma, brainstem glioma, medulloblastoma, and ependymoma. And in fact, most of, as you can see, posterior fossa tumors are malignant. In newness and infants, brain tumors are rare, mostly congenital. I mean, from the birth, they are present in these babies. How we are going to classify brain tumors? In fact, I'm going to mention to the WHO classification, which is not for the examination. Just for academic interest to complete the lecture. The classification of brain tumors is determined by their cell of origin. In a cell of origin, we consider the type of tumor. For example, the tumor of the glial tissue, I'm going to show the brain called glioma, of the choroid plexus, called plexus papilloma, of the meninges, called meningioma. Over 50% are neuroepithelial origin, 15% metastatic, 15% meningioma, and 8% pituitary tumors. The World Health Organization, WHO classification of brain tumors is outlined in the next slide as you can see. Regarding neuroepithelial tumors, are number one, nerve sheath tumors, like acoustic neuroma, meningeal tumors. In fact, when I'm going to talk about neuroepithelial tumors, I mean gliomas, whether astrocytoma or glioma, ependymoma, cutaneous papilloma, or pineal tumors, also included in the neuroepithelial tumors, the neuronal tumors, and medulloblastoma, all are considered in the group of neuroepithelial tumors. Nerve sheath tumors, like acoustic neuroma, is also another type of tumors. Meningeal tumors, I mean meningioma. And pituitary tumors. Pituitary tumors, in fact, I'm going to give you a few important points about them because they may be functioning or not functioning. And next, germ cell tumors like germinoma or teratoma, lymphoma, tumor like malformations like craniopharyngiomas, epidermal tumors or dermoid or cholecyst. And lastly, metastatic tumors, which I mentioned to you, are the most common brain tumors. To return back slightly in the table, the first type was neuroepithelial tumors. As I mentioned to you, they include either gliomas, pineal tumors, neuronal tumors, medulloblastoma. Under the subject of gliomas, like astrocytoma, oligodendroglioma, ependymomas, or choroid tumors, all are the types of neuroepithelial gliomas, and all are these types of neuroepithelial tumors. And in tumor-like malformation, which were number G, include craniopharyngiomas, epidermal tumors, dermal tumors, or cholecysts. So I repeat again that this classification is just to complete the lecture. It's not for you in the examination, inshallah. Now, regarding etiology of brain tumors, as any other tumors in the body, till now, there is no known and definite cause for brain tumors to be fixed. What I mean by this, that, for example, as you see in this slide, that we put the radiation, chromosomal abnormalities, viruses, immunosuppression, mutations in the genes. Now, many of our patients, when you see this patient, and having any type of the brain tumor mentioned in the table, the last table, then we search for a cause for these tumors, like radiation or other causes, and we are seeing that these patients have not been exposed to radiation, have no chromosomal abnormalities, no viruses, no immunosuppression, and no mutation. But in fact, they are having brain tumors. So that these are just theories supposed to be as a cause of brain tumors. The etiology of brain tumors is still not clearly understood, but these are supposed causes like radiation associated with meningioma, gliomas, and fibrosarcoma. We saw that some of the patients having these tumors were exposed in the past to radiation by any mean and resulted in these tumors. And as I told you, most of the patients have meningioma, gliomas, and fibrosarcoma have no, they have not exposed to radiation. Although there is no genetic predisposition, but chromosomal abnormalities have been noted in many CNS tumors like von Richthofen disease. Viruses, Epstein-Barr virus associated with Burkitt lymphoma and nasopharyngeal carcinoma. Immunosuppression markedly increased the incidence of primary CNS lymphoma. And lastly, mutation in the P53 tumor suppression gene is the most common gene alteration and is found in astrocytoma and meningioma. We do histopathology for this patient, and we search for this gene, sometimes find positive, sometimes find negative. So that I return back that till now, the etiology of brain tumors is still not clearly understood. Now, this is the most important part of the lecture, as I told you, which is the clinical features of brain tumors. This is the most important part of the lecture, and most of the questions in the theories, in the clinical exam, and in the oral exam, if I'm going to ask you about brain tumors, I will bring you the questions from this part of the lecture, which is the most important part of the lecture. As I told you, that you put in your mind these clinical features, symptoms, and signs, and when you are going to be faced with patients having any of them, please put a red flag and ask yourself, whether this patient may be having possibility of having brain tumors in order to send him for proper investigations. Now, brain tumors will result in one or other or combination of these following features. Maybe focal neurological deficits, as you're going to see in a few seconds or few minutes, raised intracranial pressure, seizures, and endocrine dysfunction, or incident finding that is asymptomatic or symptomless. In fact, we are faced with many patients having incident findings. I got a patient aged about 3 years, exposed to be pushed by her brother, and she fell down on stairs and got head injuries and a state of loss of consciousness. Then they brought this patient to the hospital, and as an examination important for patients with head injury, having loss of consciousness, we sent this patient for CT scan of the brain. And we were surprised by that this patient have no skull fracture, no intracranial hematoma, but she was having very big brain tumor. And so that she was not complaining from any symptom or sign before her fall on the stairs. So that maybe, as I told you, an incidental finding earlier. Regarding endocrine dysfunction, maybe resulting from mainly the pituitary tumors. And seizures sometimes can be considered as one of the focal neurological deficits because it's mainly when the tumor involving the temporal loop. Now, we are going to talk in some details about this subject. As I told you, the clinical features will be either asymptomatic, endocrine dysfunction, seizures, focal deficit, or increased intracranial pressure. Now, what are the focal deficits we are going to be faced with patients having brain tumors? This will depend on the site of the tumor, frontal loop, parietal loop, temporal loop, occipital loop, or even posterior fossa, as you're going to see. Now, if the patient is having frontal loop lesions, he will present with personality changes, gait ataxia, and urinary incontinence, contralateral hemiparesis, because it involves the motor area, contralateral hemiparesis, if posterior frontal, and expressive dysphagia, if involving dominant inferior frontal gyrus with, for example, the left side of If the patient is having parietal lobe lesions, he will present with contralateral sensory impairment. You know that the motor area present in the frontal lobe, the main part of the main motor area, main sensory area in the parietal lobe, so the contralateral sensory impairment, addressing apraxia, stereognosis, and if on the dominant side, achalcalia, agraphia, left to right disorientation, and finger agnosia. Regarding temporal lobe lesions, olfactory and auditory hallucinations, memory disturbance, contralateral superior quadrantinopia or hemiparesis, and if on the dominant side, may present with receptive dysphasia. Occipital lobe lesions associated with visual field defects because the occipital lobe contain the vision area, so that visual field deficit most commonly an incomplete contralateral homonymous hemianopia. Now, if the tumor was present in the subfrontal lesion, may involve the olfactory nerve and present with anosmia. Cellular and paracellular tumors will present with visual field problems due to compression of the optic chiasm and hypopituitarism and oversecretion syndrome such as Cushing disease and acromegaly if it affects the pituitary gland by enlargement of the pituitary gland or pressure on the pituitary gland. Cerebellar lesions, a tumor involving the cerebellar vermis, I mean the red line of the thalamus, will cause truncal ataxia, whereas tumors in the hemisphere produce appendicular signs such as incoordination and nystagmus. A brainstem and cerebellopontine angle lesions may result in cranial nerve palsies. You know that most of the nuclei of the cranial nerves are located in the brainstem. And so that if the patient presents with brainstem tumor will result in cranial palsies. Longer tract signs, because you know that brainstem will be the passage of these longer tracts, I mean the pyramidal and extrapyramidal tract, and the motor and sensory tracts going to the spinal cord. And sometimes with secondary hydrocephalus, if they will cause the enlargement of the brainstem and result in pressure or compression or closure of the fourth ventricle and result in obstructive hydrocephalus. Regarding what we call as cerebellopontine angle tumors, these lesions are located in the angle between the cerebellum and the brainstem, and from here there will be passage of the fifth cranial nerve, seventh cranial nerve, and eighth cranial nerve to their canals. And the tumors at this area, for example, schwannoma, may result in compression and affection of these nerves. Lastly, ventricular system tumors may obstruct CSF drainage and result in hydrocephalus, compounding the raised intracranial pressure. I mean, will increase more and more of the intracranial pressure, which is already raised. Now, you can see the other clinical presentation. As I told you, number one, focal deficit, which I mentioned to you in the last two slides. Then, raised intracranial pressure. Raised intracranial pressure may result from either direct mass effect, as you can see in this slide. This is very big tumor, meningioma, called olfactory meningioma. And as you see, they are compressing on the brain tissue and result in raised intracranial pressure. Vasogenic edema, you can see this is the edema. And this result also in increased intracranial pressure. Lastly, obstructive hydrocephalus, you can see this is posterior fossa tumor causing obstruction of the fourth ventricle and even hydrocephalus represent as the dilatation of the fourth of the third ventricle and even the lateral ventricle, which go down to the temporal horn, temporal lobe of the brain due to increased intracranial pressure secondary to obstructive hydrocephalus. So that present intracranial pressure is a prominent feature in brain tumors sometimes. And I will not repeat to you what are the criteria for intracranial pressure, which I mentioned to you in the second lecture. Now, seizures are quite important. In brief, put in your mind that any patient, adult patient, present to you with epilepsy, please send him for at least CT or MRI to exclude a specific spine lesion. Now, late onset epilepsy, particularly over the age of 30 years, should prompt investigation to exclude intracranial neoplasm. New onset of seizure in an adult is suggestive of intracranial blast until proven otherwise. The type of seizure may give a clue to the location of the tumor. For example, parietal lesions cause simple partial seizures, which may become secondary generalized, while medial temporal lesions will cause complex partial seizures. Now, as I told you, that seizures, newly onset seizure, will prompt you to send this patient for at least CT or MRI. Please, please, please send him to just to exclude the possibility of specified lesion. What I mean by this, if you are going to be in phase, for example, with 100 patients having seizures, and you send them, all of them, for MRI or CT, and you find that 95 patients of them were normal CT, but you catch 5 of them having brain tumors, this is quite, quite important and beneficial. يعني عندي مريض كان راجعني عمره 16 سنة جاء مريض من الحويجة أذكر 16 سنة الكومبلين مالته شنو هو جاء قالوا يعني قالوا عنده resistant epilepsy وكان يعني المعالجون ينطوه يعني الجرعة عالية من الأنتي إبليبتيك يعني الديباغي مثلا ديجريتو ديبرا أذكر 3-4 أشكال كان ده ياخذ من الأنتي إبليبتيكس و still not respond to treatment. I asked the patient family Where are the investigations? I was surprised because I saw that this patient was having four times, they did for him four times EEG, electrocardiography. And all these four EEG, they are saying abnormal EEG, abnormal EEG, abnormal EEG, abnormal EEG. But no, and this is over 4 years, and no one was sent him for CT or MRI. And as well as your CT, as the patient, your patient MRI, they said, we don't have it. We did not did it for this patient at all. I sent this patient for MRI. I was surprised by that this patient was having very big left temporal brain tumor as a cause of his seizures. Now, as I told you, the clinical presentations, personal changes in frontal lobe, headache as a feature of increased intracranial pressure. And I will not repeat that, but you must be knowing that this is morning headache as a feature of increased intracranial pressure. Associated with nausea, vomiting, as you can see, and papilledema as a feature of increased intracranial pressure. So that any neurologist or neurosurgeon, if he is faced with patient having a headache, he must examine the fundus to exclude papilledema, as you can see, the blending of the edge of the edge of the of margin of the vegetary of the ataxia in case of cerebellar tumors. Now I repeat again that the most important part of the lecture, which I just finished, which is the clinical features, may be asymptomatic, and incidental finding, endocrine dysfunction. In fact, I don't talk about it at now because I'm going to give you the information in the last topic of the lecture when I'm going to talk to you about the tumors of the pituitary gland and seizures, focal deficit, and raised intracranial pressure are the main clinical presentations. Now, what are the important investigations to be done for patients having or suspicion of having brain tumors? In fact, this investigation I mentioned to you in the first lecture and including plain skull X-rays, CT scan, computer tomography, MRI, magnetic resonance imaging, angiography, and PET scan, positron emission tomography. Regarding plain skull X-ray, it may be normal, or may show changes due to raised intracranial pressure, which I mentioned to you in the first lecture, like erosion of the posterior cranial nerve process or the copper beating marking of the skull. Sometimes local changes may occur with specific tumors like supracellular calcification in cases of craniopharyngiomas or hyperostosis and dystrophic in case of meningiomas. Now, the most important investigations are CT scan and MRI of the brain. Now, CT scan or computer tomography is going to give me the following information about the state of the patient and the state of the tumor of the patient, including the site and size of the tumor, whether I mean right frontal, also the side, right or left, the side, the frontal, parietal, occipital, temporal, brainstem lesion, cerebellar lesion, or intraventricular lesion. The size of the tumor, I can go and know very well the size of tumor by its three dimensions. Boundaries of the tumors, whether they are clear or, I mean, well-circumscribed tumors separated from the brain tissue or mixed with the tissue of the brain. If there is surrounding edema or not, and the amount of this edema will give me some clue. For example, meningioma surrounded by perifocal edema, which is comparable to the size of the tumor. But if I'm going to see small tumor surrounded by a huge edema, I'm going to put in my mind that this patient may be having metastatic brain tumor, even if I'm going to be faced with single lesion. But this huge edema will give me a clue about that this patient may be having secondary tumor. Shifting on the midline, structures by the mass due to big or enlarging tumor. Associated hydrocephalus in case of, for example, posterior fossa tumors, fourth ventricular tumor, or third ventricular tumor, and even choroidal papilloma, resulting in CSF. Body changes of the skull nearby, there may be either enlargement, thickening of the skull, or maybe opposite, the erosion of the skull. Nature of the tumor, while solid, cystic, necrotic, or calcified, and so its pathology can be guessed from the CT scan of the brain. And in fact, don't forget that to give the patient contrast after CT scan, not only native CT scan, give him contrast because some tumors will result in enhancement after contrast, other have no enhancement or little enhancement. Next investigation is MRI, magnetic resonance imaging. And in fact, it is going to give me the same information which I got from CT scan. But if you are going to ask me which one you prefer for patients suspected to have brain tumors, in fact, we are going to select MRI. MRI and CT scan. In dealing with patients having head neurosurgical problem or neurological problem, if we suspect the pathology concerning bones, we prefer CT scan. If we suspect pathology concerning soft tissue, we prefer MRI. And so that in head injury, we are talking always about CT scan, while in brain tumors, we talk more about magnetic resonance image as a preferred investigation. Although this will not, let me say that CT scan is useless. No, it is beneficial, but the better is MRI. That sometimes we are faced with patients having, for example, a headache, chronic headache, nausea, vomiting, papilledema. We sent him for, or maybe sent for by other doctor to CT scan, not MRI, and discovered to have brain tumor. Before I'm going to interfere surgically, I prefer to send the patient for MRI because some of the features will be more apparent, more clear in MRI than CT scan. This is mainly for cases of posterior fossa tumors, because you know the architecture of the posterior fossa, يعني عظام كثيرة عند posterior fossa, فممكن تأثر على during CT scan. These bones may affect on the image and measure an artifact. So that we prefer MRI for septic tumor, for septic pathologies like brain tumors. Regarding angiography, it's used to evaluate the blood supply and vasculature. In fact, angiography, you know, it is an invasive method. يعني القسطرة, قسطرة الشرايين. It's an invasive method, مثل قسطرة القلب, أيضا قسطرة الشرايين مع الدماغ. الحقيقة هذه ذكرناها كمية المحاضرة الأولى, investigations. Angiography, in fact, maybe as an investigation for diagnosis, and maybe used as therapeutic. Therapeutic أصلا بيجي بالضبط أنه بعض الأحيان patients having very big tumor like meningioma, and very vascular tumors, that it mandate me to prepare for this patient at least 10 pints of blood, because I suspect that the patient will got or will get severe bleeding during surgery. But we can decrease the amount of bleeding by doing preoperative embolization of the tumor feeding vessel. يعني في المادة الكيميائية يدفعوها عن طريق القسطرة يروح على منطقة ال blood supply to the tumor will block it. يعني قبل عملية بيومين ثلاثة مثلا نجي نشتغل المريض شو blood disc field. So that angiography diagnostic and therapeutic for brain tumors. Last investigation is PET scan. وهذا ما ذكرنا في الانفستيجيشن حديث موجود عندنا بالمصوص بعد ما اشتغل ولكن حاليا موجود في بغداد في اربيل. Can study the brain metabolism used to characterize the most malignant component of a tumor, assess the prognosis of the brain tumor, differentiate the current tumor from radiation necrosis. يعني الفوائد من هذا البيت سكان انه الرئيسيه مثلا بعض الاحيان can differentiate between benign and malignant tumor من جهه الاولى. ولهذا السبب ما قال نحكي عن البروجنوزز مع ايش اقصد بيه؟ انا اقصد بيه ان البروجنوز اوف ذيس بيشنت whether this is benign or malignant. Also, it will differentiate the recurrent tumor from radiation causes. هذه عند مشكلة صادمة كثير من المرضى أنه يجي المريض عنده brain tumor. We did for him total excision or subtotal, no problem. And after that, we discovered, for example, benign tumor with subtotal excision. طبعا هذا الجزء اللي متبقي لازم نبعثه على ايش كيموثيرابي راديوثيرابي. أما إذا malignant tumor mega tumor, even if total excision, I was sending for chemotherapy, radiotherapy. المريض تحسن بعد العملية وصار زين وراح البيت. جعلتوا له فولو اب، جاء بعد الشهر امور جيدة، شهرين امور جيدة، وراح الراديوثيرابي وصار امور زينة وراح اختفى، يعني خلينا نقول ست شهور اكثر ما في شيء او سنة. جاء بعد سنة او سنتين. ها اشبيكة اشبيكة والله وجع راسي وجعي مرة ثانية. فاشمعت المرة كان كانت هيديك They have an alarm that this patient may be having a recurrent tumor. What I'm going to do for this patient, I would send him for MRI, or let me say CT scan. And I put it in my mind that this patient, I know very well that I did for him, for example, total excision of the tumor. And this is proven even by a postoperative CT scan or MRI, there's no remnant of a tumor. But I put also in my mind that this patient is exposed to radiotherapy as a treatment modality. For this patient, and after that, I send him for MRI. MRI or CT scan revealed to me mass lesion in at the site of the tumor. Now I'm going to ask myself: this patient is having headache and having a mass lesion. Will I interfere or not? If I interfere, and he also have a tumor, he is lucky and he will get benefit. But if he is having just post radiation necrosis, he will have no benefit from surgery. No benefit from surgery. And I may harm the patient. So that how to know where this is recurrent tumor or this is just post-radiation necrosis, I am going to send the patient for PET scan, which will give me the final answer and give me the way how to deal with this patient. Now, management of intracranial tumors in general. احنا باختصار نقول ما يعني احنا باختصار نقول ما يعني. احنا جراحين، يشمل الكلام هذا. يعني لما نقول انه مريض عنده برين تيومر معناته ايش نو اكسجين، هاي خليه في بالنا. Now, the following points are to be considered when dealing with intracranial tumors as follow. Number one, if the patient shows signs of compression or raised intracranial pressure, it treat with measures that lower intracranial pressure. يعني حتى اذا جاني عندي ميني جيوما مثلا واضح التيومر and I am decided to do surgery for this patient. Before surgery, in the preparation of the patient for surgery, I am going to treat his intracranial pressure by the measures mentioned in the second lecture. If an intracranial tumor associated with hydrocephalus, the hydrocephalus is dealt with first by ventricular perfusion shown before surgery. وهذا كان كمية المحاضرة الثانية عندما تحدث عن hydrocephalus وقلنا if there's a patient having hydrocephalus plus other pathology, priority for hydrocephalus. إذا كان من عندما يرسل priority for hydrocephalus ليش؟ يختلف عن السبب اللي في حاله برين تيومر لانه يعني بنقدر ما نسير حتى نقلل البرين اتروفي. لانه يعني كل ما نتاخر بعمليه الشنطه احسن مور برين اتروفي. اما في حاله البرين تيومرز خاصه البوستيريا فوسا تيومر if I'm going to do surgery first ايش راح يصير عندي؟ ريزنت كان بريشر، بس افتح السكين، افتح البون، افتح الديورا، all the brain will be the brain will be out and there'll be herniation and the patient will die on the table. So that we're going to do first of all shunt and then do excision of the tumor. CTO MRI guides stereotactic surgery. Tumor is deeply seated in the brain. In these cases, we are going to deal with this. وهاي هاي قاعدنا تفيدنا بإيش فيدنا؟ يعني for biopsy or excision of these tumors. ليش؟ بعض الحين يجي مثلا مريض عنده multiple lesions، فما اقول انا راح اجي اشيل هاي الليج كلها وموزعها مثلا فرنتال بارايتال اوكسبيتال الى اخره. فراح اقول انه هذا سكندري برين تيومر. زين من جهه سكندري برين تيومر راح اعمل له تحري عشان بعد شويه انه 15% of patients have brain tumors have no primary source. No primary source. وللاسف نتحرى احنا ما لنا قصص فنكون مضطرين بالاخير ان ناخذ بايبسي. هاي البايبسي لانه هو سمول تيومر إذا ننزل عليه مباشرة ممكن نشوف أنه ناخذ بايبسي بعثها نقول أنه هو هذا التيومر يطلع نورمال برين تيشو. فعندنا مثل قلت ستيريوتاكتيك سيرجري أو إيمج جايد سيرجري تو فور فوكال ديفيسي فوكال يعني ديتكشن أوف تيومرز. ناو سيرجري ريسيجن أو ديباكينج فور اكسسبل تيومرز. إن كيس أوف مالجنت برين تيومرز أو ميتاستاسيس أجوفن ثيرابي رايت لايك راديو ثيرابي أند أور كيمو ثيرابي as a supplementary to surgical excision. اذا دائما دائما احنا نقول انه حط في بالنا انه اذا كان عندنا بنايه تيومر incubated excision لازم radiotherapy or chemotherapy postoperatively. اما اذا كان بلغت تيومر even if complete excision radiotherapy is a must. Now radiotherapy either conventional radiotherapy or radiosurgery. For small tumors less than 3 centimeters, which is of many types, we can deal with like linear accelerator, gamma knife, and cyber knife can be used. وهي قدول إيش عندنا يعني ما مثل قبل كان جهاز يسمون الأشعة العميقة دي بيكسي ثيرابي وكان المرضى يعني يطلعون مباشرة يساعدوا يعني الشيء الواضح جدا ذكروا أنه يعني loss of hair إلى آخره. هسه إحنا حاليا إيش نتعامل مع إيش linear accelerator more specific for the tumor, gamma knife or cyber knife. راح يعني عباره عن يعني حتى لين اكسلريتر هو عباره عن سيشنز كثيره مثلا 20 جلسه 25 جلسه مثلا. اما الجاما نايف والسايبر نايف هي عباره عن سنجل سيشن سنجل سيشن وذ ديب اكسلثيرابي راديو ثيرابي راديو سيرجري كونسنتريتد اون سمبل سنجل بوينت. هذه مثل ما تحضرون هذا جهاز الجاما نايف ويعني سلط البيب كله على نقطه واحده من جميع الجهات هاي كلها النقاط تشوفوها الدوائر سلط الاشعاع على راس المريض على نقطة واحدة فقط فيعبر بأماكن الطبيعية ما يؤذي المريض. هذه السايبر نايف اللي هي الأحدث بعد من الجاما نايف أيضا نفس الطريقة يعتمد. وهذه حكينا عن ستيريوتايب سيرجري راح نلبس المريض في الخودة هذه تشوفوها المعدنية ثبت على راس المريض قبل العملية بريبورتيفلي وندخله على سي سكان ام ار اي من خلال علاقة بين هذه الخودة نسميها الهلمت راح يعطيني ابو سي سكان ام ار اي احداثيات الاكس والواي زد وبالضبط يدخلني على مكان التيومر عن طريق هذا الجايد بعد يعني اصل مباشره على حتى اذا كان 1 سنتيمتر ان دايمتر. الان راح اتحدثكم عن يعني اخترت لكم مجموعه من البرين تيومرز which are common. I'm going to give you a few points about each one of them. First of all, basic brain tumors. As I mentioned to you, this is the most common type of all brain tumors. يعني لما نحكي على primary and secondary الموست كومن هو ميتاستاتيك برين تيومرز. It constitutes 15% of intracranial tumors. The commonest site of origin are the lungs, 40%, followed by breast, 10 to 30%. In addition to melanoma, 5 to 50%, and last kidney and colon are source of ميتاستاتيك برين تيومرز. In 15% of cases, primary source is never found. وهذا نرجع على النقطة الأولى اللي حكينا النقطة الثانية سوري. عندما قلنا the commonest site of origin is the lung. نجي ايش نعمل احنا؟ جاء مريض عنده multiple lesions in the brain قلت هذا secondary. ايش اعمل؟ اتحرى عن primary قبل ما ادخل جراحي لانه اذا ما شفته حتى اذا كان single lesion وقلت مثل ذاك ذكرنا مثلا single small lesion surrounding huge perifocal edema قلت هذا secondary حتى اللي هو يعني single lesion. فايش اعمل؟ اتحرى عن primary source لانه اذا تعاملت معانه لهذا التيومر والبرايمري موجود ما راح استفاد شيء. راح يرجع بعد كم يوم secondary في other side. فاعمل تشيست اكس راي او سي تي اوف ذا تشيست مثلا ما يكون ممكن يكون نيجاتيف. بريست فور فيميل نيجاتيف. ميلانوما نيجاتيف نوت بريزنت. كيدني اند كولون اول ار نورمال. مثل ما ذكرنا 15% ار برايمري سورس از نيفر فايند. هذا ايش راح يضيف لي؟ راح يضيف لي كسيرجري سيرجري فور ذيس بيشنت تو تيك سامبل اند تو سي وير ذا سورس اوف ذا تيومر. On CT, they only show well with intravenous contrast. يعني بالبداية ما يطلع واضح. طبعاً أيضاً MRI can be used. Steroids may help to reduce pre-tumor edema, بس هذا علاج وقتي يعني ما راح يعني يخفف وقتياً. Surgery may be appropriate for isolated metastasis. يعني إذا تلاحظون indication for surgery metastatic brain tumors is so limited. يعني ما تقول يعني metastatic brain tumor أنا راح أعمل دخل بيه surgery. لا. اصلا نشوف احنا اذا كان المريض مثلا single lesion isolated lesion مثلا وبيج lesion ممكن ادخل surgically to the excision of the tumor. The other indication if I did not know the primary source فراح اخذ biopsy not for excision of tumor but I want to know the source of the tumor. And the other indication is shown is how you see CSF shunts used for lesion causing high syphilis, for example, secondary brain tumor inside the third ventricle, causing obstructive syphilis, or secondary brain tumor inside the fourth ventricle, or outside the fourth ventricle, compressed on the fourth ventricle, or outside the third ventricle, compressed on the third ventricle, and result in high syphilis, so that shunt will be treatment for not for a tumor, but for the complication of the tumor, I mean high syphilis. Radiotherapy can be used for multiple metastasis. وهون نركز على الجاما نايف is very good for these patients. As you can see in this slide, these are multiple lesions inside the brain. 1, 2, 3 post-mortem specimen, coronary section. This is metastatic brain tumor. You can see this the lesion is surrounded by a huge perifocal edema. It's a brain tumor with surrounding perifocal edema. MRI of patients having multiple metastases, you can see this coronary section of MRI, multiple lesions indicative of of metastases. And the slide J هو نفس المريض بس أخذنا axial section في هذا المكان بالضبط، في المكان أخذنا axial section، فعندي فقط هذا lesion واحد اللي هو metastatic brain tumor. Other type of brain tumors, which I'm going to talk about, are gliomas. They are derived from cells of glial origin. ذكرناكم بداية المحاضرة that gliomas are the most common primary brain tumors, most secondary. They are the commonest of primary CNS neoplasm, comprise about 50% of adult intracranial tumors, primary intracranial tumors. They are of four types, astrocytoma, oligodendroglioma, ependymoma, and cornuplex papilloma, the most common of which is astrocytoma. Its survival is closely associated with grading. اكو عنده جريد يعني يختلف عندما ندخل التفاصيل يعني باختصار كل ما يكون هاي جريد كل ما يكون سرفايفل مالته ما يكون اقل. اكو عنده كلاسيفيكيشن مثلا يقول لك مثلا جريد 1 2 3 4. اذر جريدنج يسميها استوسايتوما او يسميها لو جريد جلايوما انا بلاستيك استوسايتوما او جلايبوستوماتيفورمي. هاي ما بيمثل لكم انتم خلوا ببالكم انه كل ما الجريد يكون اقل كل ما يكون سرفايفل اطول. حتى يعني ما يدخل تفاصيل اخرى انه عندنا خلاف حول لوغريد جلايوما تعتبر بيان تيومر and may be managed by just close observation of the tumor. Treatment involves surgery and radiotherapy and or chemotherapy. Now you can see جلايوما مثل ما تلاحظون ليش عليه خلاف كثير وكلام كثير ما ندخل تفاصيله انه هي راح تصير يعني infiltrating the brain tissue. فتخلوا في بالكم اكسجين معناتها انه it will leave the patient with focal deficit, which is different. Other astrocytomas, you can see also involved with the deep seat inside the brain. هذه الاستوما pre contrast و post contrast the same picture. لما يكون بالشكل هذا وانه هذا ما عنده low grade glioma يعني بالعين. Other MRI showing to you also tumor and after contrast there is no change, means low grade tumor. هذا الاخر راح تلاحظون انه هذا هو التيومر وليس هاي السواد هذه perfect edema. لاحظوا افتر كونتراست كلش واضح انه هذا التيومر دي بي سي دي تيومر بيبي تيومر ذيس از مالجنت جلايوما حتى لاحظوا ميد لاين شيفت توكا مش هو ذا فيتيكلز مارين جيوماز مارين جيوماز ذي ار سلولي جروينج اكسترا اكزيال تيومرز اند يوجوالي ذي ار بي لاين ريرلي تو بي مالجنت ذيس اكونت فور 15% اوف intracranioplasm, I mean, for primary, and they are the most common benign neoplasm. They occur more frequently in women than in men, and their incidence peak in the middle age, 40 to 60. يعني اكو شيء متشابه بينه وبين ايش؟ بين الجول بلادر وبين بين تكن هايبرتنشن حكينا عن سي تيومر سيلبري. يعني افكت فيميلز مور ذان وومن مور ذان مين اند ميدل ايج، يعني نفس ذكرون الفيميل فاتي 40 الى اخره. التيومر رايز فروم من ميزوثيليال سيلز اوف ذا اركنويد اوف ذا اركنويد فيلاي. Classically arises from a broad base along the dura. يعني بالبرتيش مع شو بعد شوي عندي يعني broad base. They may invade the bone. Invasion of the bone by these tumors may result in either one or of two things: either erosion of the bone or hyperostosis. يعني thickening of the bone. They derive their blood supply from the external carotid circulation. يعني مو من internal carotid, but external carotid circulation. Benign meningiomas are relatively rare. The symptoms and signs are related to those of intracranial mass lesion or seizures, causing a contemporary loop. CT scan accurately diagnose the lesion. Complete surgical removal, causing a cambium, usually result in a cure, and the patient will go to live a normal life. هذا هاي من اليوم هاي pre contrast sorry يعني هي pre contrast هتكون hyper dense with regard to the brain tissue. Now after contrast there's enhancement, homogeneous enhancement of the tumor. Other meningioma by MRI pre-contrast or high post contrast, the same patient must place this axial view. The other bone infection by H on hyperostosis. قارن مع الجهة الثانية شو عنده thickened bone. هون عنده erosion of the bone of skull by the meningioma. آخر شيء عندنا هو pituitary tumors. Pituitary tumors انقسم الى نوعين، نون فانكشنينج بيتر ادينوماز اور فانكشنينج بيتر ادينوماز. هاي البيتر ادينوما اسرع نضيف لها. يعني ما نجي على البرزنتيشن مالتهم ايضا نقول ما بي سيمبتوم بس ما بي ريزنت بريشر ما بي فوق الديفيسيت اسرع تعمل لي مثل ما ذكرنا اذا بريشر اون ذا بيتر ستار اذا هومونيموس هيمي انيوبيا باي تمبورال هومونيموس هيمي انيوبيا ولكن يضاف لها اذر فيتشر اللي هي هرمونال ديستربنس ان ذا بيشنت. خاصة إذا كانت functioning pituitary adenomas. إذا كان non-functioning pituitary adenoma, it will behave just like any other tumors. يعني maybe symptomless, maybe resistant pressure, maybe focal deficit. أما إذا صارت functioning, we will add to it the hormonal disturbances. Adenomas مثل ما ذكرنا may be further divided derived according to the size of the tumors either as microadenoma or macroadenoma. طبعا هذا classification يعني يمشي سواء كان functioning or non-functioning. Microadenoma that are less than 1 centimeter in diameter and macroadenoma larger size أكثر من 1 centimeter. Now regarding non-functioning adenomas, they account for about 30% of pituitary adenoma tumors. معناته 70% حيكون functioning. They are often seen in the fourth and fifth decade of life. يعني لاحظوا انه ما تشوف بالميدل ايج اور يونغ، اكثر شيء بال old age. Because they are of non functioning, they are not generally diagnosed until they are very big, very large in size حتى يكون بين. Their presentation is by optic chiasm compression that cause visual field defect by temporal hemianopia. The usual treatment is microscopic transsphenoidal or transcranial excision. وراح اشوفكم بعدين بالاخير الصور شلون فوت على transsphenoidal. تعرفون البيتوتري السايت مالها كلش ديب سيتد. يعني ما ماتي عليها هي بعيده. يعني تجي عليها من البرايتال بعيده جدا. من الفرنتال لازم ارفع الفرنتال كله اللي فوق حتى تصل الى حد مكان البيتوتري تيومر. ولهذا السبب ابتكروا الطريقه الجديده اللي يستخدمها حاليا اللي هي transsphenoidal. الترانسفينويد عن طريق النوز على السفينويد سايرس ثم يدخل الى التيومر مباشره. راح اشوف بعد شوي يصير بالاخير. While functioning pituitary adenomas classified according to the hormones they secrete. ما بس انه مايكرو او مايكرو ادينوما وانما حسب الهرمون سكريت. مثلا برولاكتين سكريتيك ادينوماز اذا كان في سكريت برولاكتين. Growth hormone secreting adenomas that produce acromegaly and gigantism. Glycoprotein secreting adenomas that produce excess amount of TSH, LH, and FSH. ICT secreting adenomas that produce Cushing disease, and some of these secrete more than one hormone, example, prolactin, growth hormone secreting adenomas. Functioning adenomas are diagnosed by either clinical changes, hormone assessment, and radiology by using MRI and CT scan. Regarding prolactinomas, represent about 40% of all pituitary adenomas. They cause amenorrhea, galactorrhea, and infertility in women, while in men they cause impotence or maybe asymptomatic. Bromocriptine, which is anti-prolactin drug, has virtually replaced surgery as a treatment of choice for prolactinoma. وهذه فوائد يعني قفزة كانت نوعية كبيرة جدا أنه بعض يعني مو دائما نفكر سيرجري سيرجري سيرجري. نحاول مع المريض بعض الأحيان يعني برومكربتين as a method as anti-prolactin may result in resolving decreasing the size of the tumor and disappearance of tumors. Surgical excision can preferably done by using transsphenoidal route, whether sublabial يعني من تحت الشفة or transnasal. Although transcranial approach can also be used sometimes إذا كانت حالات خاصة عملية تفاصيل يعني إذا كانت tumor localized على السيليا تورسيكا ندخل transsphenoidal أسهل بالنسبة لنا. إذا كان كنصائق extension supercell extension وراح على الأطراف يعني حتى supercell extension إذا كان vertical ممكن عن طريق transsphenoidal مع ما نشيل احنا التيومر من جوا راح ينزل التيومر فوق وينزل علينا، ولكن اذا كانت سوبرسيل اكستنشن في الاخر على الاطراف بهذيك الحاله ما يكفي الترانسفير لازم يكون اما يكون معاه الترانسكرينين او الترانسكرينين. Now in case of invasive tumor with incomplete excision, radiotherapy is required postoperatively. يعني بهذا نكون تقريبا انتهينا من الموضوع مع بين التيومرز بس نخلي في بالنا ما يلي. برومكريبتين هذا as a drug anti-prolactin هو ما عبارة مو كيموثيرابي وإنما for a drug anti-hormon وراح تلاحظوا أنه هذا الدرج الوحيد يعني هذا التيومر الوحيد اللي يمكن يتعالج without chemotherapy by this حتى without surgery by this drug only. Okay. You can see for example this is epithelial tumor. لاحظوا internal carotid artery عندما ندخل هذا transphenous sinus ندخل مباشرة إلى التيومر. وليش كان صار عندي هاي سيليا تورسيك هذا حدها فسوبر سيليا اكستنشن بس كان صار فيرتيكال هذا التيومر اجي من سبينس ساينس من النوز الى سبينس ساينس وابدي اتناوش التيومر مع ما انا اشيل التيومر اسرع يصير هذا كله راح ينزل حتى هذا الفيرتيكال اما لو كان طلع التيومر على الاطراف اما مخالف ويمين يسار لا ما اتوقع راح يجي بشكل كامل. هذه ترانسفينويدال مثل ما تلاحظون عن طريق النوز وصل الى احد سبينس ساينس ثم عبر الى السيليا تورسيك وشال التيومر. اخر سؤال حقيقه بملاحظه مهمه جدا خلوها في بالكم. Don't forget with regard to brain tumors. يا سته يعني ملخص المحاضره الحين نتكلم عن الكلينيكال برزنتيشن اوف ذا بيشنت واخذنا انواع من التيومرز ميتاستاسيز بايومرز مينينجيومرز تيومرز. Don't forget please that the most significant finding pointing to integrated tumor on physical examination are the measures of papilledema and size of focal damage to the nervous system يعني focal deficit. ولهذا السبب سبب التيومر suspected lumbar puncture is contraindicated as it may precipitate fatal cloning of the brain or herniation of brain stem through the foramen magnum and may result in death of the patient. ولهذا السبب يعني نقول انه يتعامل بحذر مع المريض عنده هيديك نتحرى عن المريض نعمل له يعني examination for fundoscopy to examine papilledema وحتى اذا ما papilledema send the patient for CT or MRI. مثل ما ذكرنا تبعث 100 مريض عن سي تي ام ار اي اون ذا سبيشال برين تيومر وطلع عندك 95 من النورمال ويو كاتش 5 اوف ذيم وير اب نورمال ذيس از جود جين فور يو اند فور ذا بيشنت. ثانك يو فور ليسننج. اف يو هاف اني كويشن بليز.